Okay, very good evening. So I thought I'll just quickly discuss a few questions. Mostly most of them are memory based and from organic chemistry. Some of them are from inorganic. I have not really I don't really remember any questions from physical chemistry, so I'm not going to discuss that. And in case you want me to solve some aptitude based questions also, I have solutions to 15 questions, I think, out of the 20. Let me know. I will post that one as well. Okay, just let me know in the comment section. Now, I would not be discussing the detailed solution. Quickly, I'll just be glancing through the appropriate solutions, like maybe a little bit explanation I might give. So this is the first question, which was dependent on the topicity of protons. They were asking for this. So you can say it's a biphenyl system and does not have a chiral center. But when you do the replacement method and you replace one of the hydrogens by some other functional group, okay, any other atom, for example, this over here will become a chiral center, right? This one over here will become a chiral center. But once this becomes a chiral center, what will happen? Both of them were ethyl groups first, but now you replace this with some other group. So now what happens? This biphenyl system also becomes you can say it also becomes chiral in nature. Okay, it has some kind of asymmetry associated with it. So now you will have this biphenyl system which has become chiral. So basically, you have generated two chiral centers, not two chiral centers, but you have basically generated a diastereomer by replacing only by making one substitution. You have generated a you will generate diastereomers because let's say this biphenyl system is now also having some kind of optical rotation. Okay, so let's say this is R. Now this center can be S, or this center can be R. So you basically have a diastereotopic relationship, and over here the protons will be diastereotopic. Then there was two questions from natural products. One was based on muscon, that what is it? So it's a terpene, okay, and basically it's used basically musk smell that you have in deodorants, that's because of this compound. And then there was a question based on carbon NMR, that which of the natural products show the value at 218 ppm. So that was camphor. Then there was a four marker on NMR spectroscopy. For this is the correct structure. Okay, sorry, I have missed out an oxygen. There will be oxygen over here. So this is going to be the correct structure for the NMR spectroscopy based question. Then there was this was a 4 marks, right? Then this was, and this I think was option number A, if I'm not wrong, but this is the structure. Then we had a question for your IR stretching frequency. So the ketene will have the highest stretching frequency, followed by a cyclopropanone, and then finally the simple ketone. Right, then there was another simple question based on the carbocation stability. So your aryl carbocation followed by your primary carbocation and then your vinyl carbocation. So this is going to be the correct order of the stability. Then there was one more question, which was this starting material was given to us. First LDA we were adding, and then after LDA we were adding your, so this was on asymmetric synthesis, right? And then you were adding your benzyl bromide. So basically your benzyl bromide will be attached below the plane over here. Okay, at this position it will be attached below the plane. Okay, then there was one more question that I forgot to discuss or forgot to write. Actually, I just remembered on decarboxylation. So for that, the correct order of decarboxylation was that first we'll have pyridine, followed by benzene, and then in the end we will have the indole system. Okay, so this is the correct order of your decarboxylation. First fastest will happen for pyridine, then benzene, and then your indole system. Okay, then let's go to the next question. Okay, I have missed out one. No, I've done all. So let's go to the next ninth question. So this was the lactone given to us, and then it was given that it was a enantiomeric, like it was a specific. Okay, it had this very specific. It was a very specific enantiomer, and then some reagent was given to us, and the ring opening of the lactone was taking place, and they wanted to ask that what kind of stereochemistry will be there between the carboxylic group and the ester group. So the answer was that they will be syn and the product will be racemic. Okay, then there was this question that was repeated from December 2019 examination. So this product that I have drawn over here, okay, this will be generated under kinetic conditions in presence of potassium hydroxide at 0 degree Celsius, and I think ethanol was given to us as the solvent, and this will be generated in acidic conditions, which will be the thermodynamic product. Okay, so this where the two methyl substituents are there at the second and third position. This is the thermodynamic product, and this over here is your kinetic product. Then there was a question where tertiary butyl lithium was given to us, and followed by like tertiary butyl lithium, and then iodine, like diethyl iodide, was given to us. So again, very very similar to a previous year question in December 2019. Over here, iodine will be attached at the fourth position. Okay. Then there was another question. This was from your I don't remember the name of the reaction as it is, like honestly, but it was like camphor sulfonic acid was given to us and formaldehyde was given to us, I think, right? So this was given to us, camphor sulfonic acid and formaldehyde. There was, I think, one question. So for that, some rearrangement will take place. We'll get a 7-membered ring and we'll get a 5-membered ring. Then there was a question on Nazarov cyclization. So for that, this was the correct answer. Okay, this was the question on Nazarov cyclization. Then there was another question which was based on your Sugi-Trost reaction, for which the correct, there were two questions actually based on the Sugi-Trost reaction. For one of them, this is the correct answer. The another one was also there. I discussed the solution to that as well. So this was one of them, and this is the correct answer. Then there was a question which was based on your hard and soft acid base concept. So over here, these were the two reactants given to us, and sodium hydride was given to us. So in this case, in both the cases, it will basically form N minus, and over here it will form S minus. But N minus is a, you can say, hard nucleophile, so it will attack the hard electrophilic center. That means it is going to attack the ester. It will form O minus. O minus will migrate back, and this ester will eliminate. So basically, you'll get a 5-membered ring with something like this. Okay, something like this you'll get over here. But what will happen? It will give 1,4 addition because it's a soft nucleophile. It will attack this position. It will give 1,4 addition. Then it will form O minus. Okay, so something like this will happen. So in the case of ester, in the case of thiol group, basically you will get something like this. Okay, so this is five, both you'll get 5-membered ring, but the product is going to be slightly different. Then this was a very, very good question. Over here, actually, what happened? Most of you might think that what I've written down is incorrect. Most of you might think that the two methyl groups should come over here, but this is actually an example of double sigma tropic reaction. Double sigma tropic reaction, double 3,3 sigma tropic reaction will take place. So what will happen? Whatever structure was there originally, for those of you who remember this question. There's a double sigma tropic reaction that is taking place. That means you will get the same substituent. Okay, otherwise what would have happened? These two methyl groups would have been attached over here, but that is not the case. It will not happen. This is a very classic example of synthesis of coumarin molecule where double sigma tropic reaction takes place. Okay, then there was one more question from organic where bromine was given to us, like the cyclohexane structure was given to us, and they were asking what is the orientation of bromine. So there were two products. In product number A, the orientation was axial, and in product number B, it was equatorial. Basically, there was one, I don't remember the exact thing, but in one case, the methyl and bromine were attached on the same carbon. So for that case, it would be axial, and for the other case, it is equatorial. Okay. Then there was some questions that I remember from organometallic. There was this very simple question where cyclopentadiene sandwich compound was given for iron ferrocene, and then H2SO4 was being added. So basically, hydrogen will attach to the iron, and a positive charge will be generated on the complex. So basically, it will follow the 18 electron rule, and this will be the correct answer. Then there was a question on Vesper theory. For that, SO3 minus is trigonal pyramidal, CO3 2 minus is trigonal planar, and BrF4 minus is square planar. That was very simple. Then there was one question on Alfred-Rochereau electronegativity scale. So for that, the correct answer was that it is directly proportional to the Z effective and inversely proportional to the R square value. Okay. Then there was a very, very straightforward question from BD Gupta. That is, when we have iron cyclopentadiene whole twice, CO twice, then at low temperature and at high temperature. Basically, it was a question based on Fluxionian behavior. So for this, the correct answer was that at low temperatures, we'll get the 5 is to 2 is to 2 is to 1. This was one like this will get at low temperatures, and at high temperature, we will get only, I think, one peak. I'm not sure actually, it's either 1 or 2. I'm getting confused, but I think it is either 1 or 2. Like, this is confirmed 5 is to 2 is to 2 is to 1. I think this is 1. Okay, at high temperatures, we will get one peak, and at low temperatures, we will get 5 is to 2 is to 2 is to 1. I think this is the right answer. I'm not sure about this. Okay, then we had a question on atomic term symbol. So, for this, so your correct answer is 3 sigma G positive for N2 positive. Okay. Then there was one simple question from IUPAC nomenclature, which I remember. So the difference was that I think in option number one, it was given 1-propyl, 2-ethyl. Okay. And in option number two, it was given 2-ethyl, 1-propyl. Basically, you'll go like this 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Like you'll go something like this. So but over here, the difference was that you had to basically, you go alphabetically. So you have to write ethyl first and propyl later. So it would have been 2-ethyl, 1-propyl. So that was something which was important. Rest, I think it was fairly simple. Then there was one question that was based on carbene where we had been given two equivalents of pH, like benzaldehyde, two equivalents of benzaldehyde was given, and then some carbine was given to us, like if I remember correctly, something like this, CH2N2 was given to us. So a carbine will be generated, and then copper catalyst was given, so a carbonoid will be generated, and then you know this oxygen will attack that carbine, which is electrophilic in nature, and then you know then that carbene will convert into a carbanion, that carbanion will further attack, you know, I'm not drawing the mechanism, but ultimately you will get this as the product. Okay, this I've drawn over here. Then we also had a question on where, like, I think phenanthrolene complex was given to us and NH3 was given to us, that mechanism was going by outer sphere, and we wanted to know that what could be the correct answer for this. So NH3 will lead to a very slow reaction. Okay, so NH3 over here will lead to a slow reaction, and the coordination number over here was 6. I think this was one of the options, coordination number 6, and NH3 will lead to a slow reaction. Then there was a complex of Fe4 carbon CO hold twice. Okay, for that the correct answer was butterfly. And then there was another organic chemistry question where very, very interesting actually. There were two questions which are based on Wittig reaction. Okay, one of them was this, and then there was, I think, one more question that was based on Wittig reaction. So two questions came from Wittig aspect. So over here, the thing is that your triphenylphosphine and your silyl protecting group was given to us. So what would have happened over here is that your phosphorus would have got attached over here. Okay, and then it will form OTMS or whatever silyl protecting group was given to us. Then what would happen is that you are adding N-butyl lithium, and positive charge will be there on phosphorus. So basically it will generate our Wittig reaction over here. Okay, it will over here generate our Wittig reaction. When you add butyl lithium, it will generate your Wittig reagent. And then butanol was given to us. Okay, then butanol, that is aldehyde, was given to us. So it will form an alkene over here. And then TBAF is given. TBAF will deprotect the silyl protecting group. Okay, then this bond will migrate over here. This bond will migrate over here. And obviously there's a double bond over here. Ultimately, you'll get something like this. Okay, you'll get the product something like this. Okay, where, so this would be, I think there will be a double bond over here as well. Right. So this is going to be the final product. So these are some of the questions that I remembered. In case you want me to make a question on the aptitude aspect as well, the solutions for the aptitude section, let me know down in the comment section. And in case you disagree with any of the answers, or if you want some clarification, let me know down in the comment section. Okay. So anyway, I hope your exam went well. It was a tough one, no doubt about it. But I hope that the cutoff goes low and most of you are able to qualify. Thank you for watching this video. If you liked it, please give it a big thumbs up, and do not forget to share it with your friends. That's about it. Thank you. Hey guys, so I'm a verified educator on Unacademy, and along with that, I'm also available on the Unacademy Plus platform, where I'm taking live classes along with other educators. So in case you're interested in attending the live classes, you can subscribe to the Unacademy Plus platform using my referral code, that is SETHI SETI, and that will give you 10% discount. Alright, and in case you're not interested in attending the live classes, you can watch the free courses that are available on the Unacademy. For that, all you need to do is go to the Unacademy website or download the Unacademy learning app and search my name over there, that is ACETI. Once you do that, you will get the access to all the free courses that are available on the Unacademy platform.